lineup and then had it really fall through spectacularly, at least you can say whatever they decide moving forward, both these top laners getting plenty of practice in competitive games.
And that's exactly what they want, as we are into game two here in this best of two. World Leader on the blue side now, and LGD, of course, over on the red. Thresh, Aurelia, the first two bans for World Elite, and Xerath once again targeted Ninja, banned by LGD.
So it'll be interesting to see what World Elite is willing to give up and what they're going to really prioritize right here, because that's a lot of team communication and analyst work into what the ideal draft is. So it's been the reality that it's been the red side that seems to be getting the better of these early games, just because you're picking up those two priority picks. But of course, that was LGD winning on the blue side, something that we haven't seen that commonly in first games in the LPL so far. So whatever they prioritize would be interesting, but we're seeing some adaptations right here. For example, we do see the Lissandra ban.
Yep, so the Lissandra ban for World Elite, Rek'Sai ban over on LGD side. Do not want to let that champion through. And that was definitely one of the biggest things to hear, is Jarvan's the last ban as well. World Elite's drafting in general, but especially that last game, just has not looked that clean.
And it starts off well. Obviously, there's those strong meta picks that are going to be the pick ban in any series, but they haven't really been having complete ideas in their team comps. It's never like, oh, these champions fit together so well, or these champion synergies have a true identity to them. But the one thing you can say is that at least hovering over a very strong pick right here in Cassidy.
It'll be pretty interesting to see either Oluka or Ninja take Cassidy into battle, but something has to change here. You can't let Sivir Nar go fourth and fifth in a draft on this patch and expect things to go well, and they didn't, unfortunately, for World Elite, but we'll see what they want. This would be a great blocker pick. That would as well, actually. Again, some very strong picks being let through, and World Elite, they do settle on Nar.
And I was about to reason out loud that the one time we've seen Ninja kind of vary his champion pool, pick up that Zed, it was perhaps the most one-sided series of the LPL so far. It didn't really seem to fit his playstyle whatsoever, so the Kassadin, it doesn't really feel like World Elite have a Kassadin player, which, given how strong that champion is in the meta right now, it's a concerning fact.
You'll have to see. Hits kind of looking through. Not that many junglers banned out this time, so no Elise revisit for Xuan, probably. Currently hovering over Lee Sin. We'll see if he wants to go for that. And LGD, as is common on the red side, that's why we see so many strong game ones on the red side in the LPL. In this patch, it seems like you get two very strong picks, and it's worth trading for the one, and they are going to get Janna and Lee Sin as their one and two.
And they're importantly in no way pigeonholing their comp whatsoever with the Janna Lee Sin picks. Obviously, a jungler in support, but very supportive aspects to both. We've got engage potential from the jungle, jungle pressure guaranteed from level 3 onwards. A very flexible draft here so far, and we've seen Azir locked in, so at least they're going for something a little bit different in the mid lane. It isn't quite the same long range we've seen from the Xerath. It is the Azir, who has the potential to be a very lane-dominating champion.
Yeah, and still feels quite a lot like a Ninja champion, I guess.
We've
seen that he likes a lot of Xerath, a lot of the safer long-range champions. Azir can definitely provide that level of comfort, for Ninja as well, especially with Xerath banned out. Rengar, though, was the other pick here for Spirit. He's going to go back to a very comfort pick for himself.
Yeah, I mean, the Rengar, Spirit has shown some snowball potential in that Rengar. We actually did see a series where Rengar was at least 2 or 3-0. And I thought, all right, if they found the champion that really he can propel from the jungle and show, and it was banned in the first series, so there obviously is a level of respect towards Spirit's ability on that champion. But it's going to be a lot of heavy lifting, I think, here.
And I feel like Spirit in a lot of game twos goes back to Rengar, and that's definitely something that's worth going on, as we do actually have our first Kalista, I believe, of the LPL. Rumble in there as well, but whatever. Imp's got Kalista.
And I'm sure our viewers have been watching the likes of Sneaky and other people really taking Kalista into solo queue and showing very excellent results in that champion. We actually don't know what to expect in terms of Kalista build. Obviously, the Hurricane first Kalista and attack speed Kalista builds have been favored just because it allows you to abuse that passive so regularly. So we have no idea what to expect from him, but at least it's something really exciting to take into what should be a fairly one-sided matchup. The Caitlyn hover for STYZ. That is his trademark champion right there. If he's going to do anything, it's going to be on that champion. So I do like the World Elite lineup they've assembled right here. It does a lot of things interestingly. But LGD has some really powerful picks.
Yeah, Morgana, Caitlyn, the last few picks there. So again, the game two trend for World Elite seems to be going for a lot of comfort once they've kind of lost that first game. Maybe they should do it the opposite way, where they take all the comfort picks in game one, but tried to mix it up. That didn't work out. Got a lot of strong champions for them. And now a last pick for LGD. Unfortunately, no PY or Annie to go with the Kalista. That would have been pretty sweet.
Well, way less. He did pick out this Zed against Dade, of course, very notably in the last series of last week's games here. So Zed could be the potential. Of course, Zed is a wonderfully strong pick against Azir, because Azir's one weakness is champions that can really gap close and get on top of him in team fights. So that's what Zed does best. He's all about that single target assassination. It's a smart pickup here, and it's kind of on Aluka to really level up, get those armor items in, get tanky, and be the answer to Zed's split push here.
And with all that, the draft is complete. Love the picks across the board here. Worldly, again, stuff that they practice on that they're definitely comfortable with. Certainly noticed that Spirit likes to go back to Rengar a lot. I think he's played probably 60%+ at least of his game twos in the LPL on Rengar. And the thing is, you mentioned Rengar, very snowballer champion, can be great to get some of your lanes ahead. Maybe the question here is for Elite though, who is Spirit really trying to get ahead here? Who's worth ganking for? Who can really bring it up? Is it STYZ's Caitlyn?
I feel like maybe the pathing in this game will answer that question for us, because obviously the team is communicating priorities and the team has an idea of what they're looking for, but it just hasn't shown through to the viewer or to us, the trained eye, on what to expect from a World League victory. I mean, they haven't had one yet in the season so far, so there's a lot of questions left unanswered. And of course, maybe the most interesting question is what to make of this Kalista pick from Imp.
Well, that's exactly what I wanted to ask you, but I guess we'll see as we get into the game. Very excited to see what a player like Imp with such incredible mechanical skill can do in a champion like Kalista, though.
And there's a lot of questions, like will it be a standard 2v2 lane? Caitlyn obviously always strong in a 1v1 situation, and Kalista's kind of slow to get going. That's when she starts hitting those attack speed caps, really getting those levels in her E ability. We've seen mostly the rend max on Kalista's just to take advantage of that uncapped damage potential that you can get with that ability. There's a lot of potential there, but I think we're going to go into game.
Yeah, with that, let's get right into it. It is LGD versus World Elite Game 2. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to Summoner's Rift here for our Game 2 between World Elite and LGD. World Elite on the blue side will be our left-hand team for this game. LGD on the red, their upper game here, and again, had a very strong start. And the question, Papa Smithy, on everybody's mind, what can Imp do with Kalista?
I mean, the sky's the limit for a champion like Kalista, who has so many different little intricacies to her kit. The uncapped damage on Rend, acting like a mini smite once you get a significant amount of attack speed, and some levels on that ability allow you to really split. I mean, I wouldn't be surprised to see World Elite picking up this champion, just because if you want to go for that split push jungle strategy, having a backup smite on your AD carry is a really interesting mechanic. Obviously, once you start getting that attack speed up, your teamfight movement, the difficulty to hit any sort of skill shots on a Kalista is just maddening to play against. So the world's the limit for Kalista. She's such an interesting champion, such a unique flavor with that passive. And it'll be exciting to see her debut on the LPL scene, to see what we can expect moving into the later stages of this LPL.
Yeah, we actually did see the hover from STYZ as well, so he was considering it, but he does have his comfort pick of Caitlyn here. And if they do get the 2v2 lane, which I believe they're looking for here, our World Elite, then that will be, presumably with the long range, quite good here. Kind of curious to see, maybe LGD just think, you know what, we feel confident, let's just run it 2v2 with Janna Kalista.
Maybe it'll be a learning exercise for the LGD bottom lane, obviously fantastically strong at Imp and PYL. If they feel like they can learn from something of running this in an unfavorable matchup in a 2v2, maybe that's the best way to use the time.
Well, we'll have to see here as junglers are going to start on the opposite sides of the map. Aluka Spirit here going to go Gromp into blue, and it should be the same pattern there for Schwen as well.
Yep, it's just the Gromp start coming out from Lee Sin right here, and we're going to see standard lanes. So I don't really know what to expect of this lane matchup. I have to give it to Caitlyn based on at least the potential and the powerful nature of early laning, but I'm ready to be surprised.
Yeah, you can see Imp, they're already bonded with PYL as well. That, I think, is both true out of game as well between these two players. They are so good together and now finally truly bonded. For the first time here, Janna is going to be the support over here. UJ with a good binding, though the trades do come in, actually, in PYL. Getting pretty aggressive early on. STYZ, they will answer back, comes in for a bit of trading.
Yeah, Imp ate a binding at level 1 and lost half his hit points, and that's kind of the nature of most Caitlyn matchups. If you ever hit any sort of CC on the enemy champion, so much potential laning burst and trading coming out of Caitlyn.
Yeah, Kalista as well, not the champion that you expect to be being hit by bindings all that often as well, but it will take a little while for that martial poise to be quite a lot stronger. Movement speed and I believe attack speed both play into that as well.
And there's a lot of unique aspects to Kalista as a champion. Obviously, she's the only champion in the game who can't cancel auto attacks, so if you hit the correct line skill shot and for whatever reason the auto attack doesn't go off and you don't reposition, it is easy to eat the sort of bunny you wouldn't expect from other AD carries. So a very intriguing champion. And one of those things where the sky's the limit when it comes to their potential.
Imp, they're going to get a bit aggressive. Good shield there from PYL. UJ now going to take a little bit of damage as well. Imp posturing pretty aggressively so far on Kalista in this lane. Happy to take it to STYZ.
Yeah, and I think in the early laning phase, you're going to have to give it to an experienced Caitlyn player like STYZ. It's after the first buy whether we start seeing which kind of build to expect from Imp and maybe his skill matchup, as a skill maxing. We're going to expect the Rend max, but could be anything.
Yeah, it looks like both junglers have actually traded jungles a little bit here as well. I think they've both gone vertical here, but it looks like they'll both be level 3 with double buffs around this time. So not too bad. Here's Schwann up the top, actually looking for a Luka on this Gnar. Pretty squishy, taking a lot of damage from the Rumble. Gonna dive in for the dive. Good bounce there from a Luka, but the flashball there from Flame gonna go in now, and a Luka just gets crushed by Schwann's Listen.
Excellent juggling of the turret right there. First blood already. The momentum already on the LGD side. And there's SDYZ taking a big damage train, but the teleport comes in.
Flame is going in now. He wants the kill so bad. UJ getting aggressed on as well. Flame, good exhaust there coming through. The heal's forced to be used out as well. First Harpoon lands. Second one just wide there. Imp gonna chase in, not be able to do too much though, and Flame will actually turn around, be a bit annoying there in the Rumble, but looks like he'll walk away.
I feel like that was a bit of an overconfident teleport coming out from Flame right there. Didn't feel like there was really much potential getting too much out from that trade, and of course he had the lane in a wonderful spot in the top lane right here, so he loses out on potential CS and also time in lane. He's actually sticking around bottom lane looking for any potential re-engage right here. But unnecessary was that teleport, I have to say.
And let's maybe back up a little here. This might be the first time that a team has ever played 1v1 against Flame.
That's true.
In the LPL.
I didn't even consider that. Of course, the 1v1 god, as he was known, Flame, really struggled when the lane swap meta really started to favor Acorn, his nemesis, but also his teammate in this LGD team. Gets the 1v1 lane finally.
Wayless in trouble. Ninja looking for a solo kill. Exhaust comes down though. Schwann now in as well. Ninja will probably die here as well. Does go down. Actually, Wayless gets credit for the kill with the ignite. Good supporting work there from Schwann. And a 1v1 though. Good work for Ninja though. Finally getting action in the
mid lane. That
was
actually very smart play from Schwann, just because he noticed the ignite tick was going and he cancelled his auto. He could have got the exit kill if he needed to. Spirit has to blow flash to get away from the Lee Sin Q right there. Losing his summoner spell for nothing.
Yeah, Flame back in the top lane now. Azor going to clean some minions out here with an early Seeker's Arm Guard to assist him.
I mean, it is worth noting that finally he gets this 1v1 lane, and it's such an unfavorable matchup for Rumble right here. Of course, in the early lanes, if he can take advantage of a minion R, there's the potential to DPS down that champion. But once Mega Nugget starts getting going, once this Hex Drink is finished, not a fun matchup for Flame.
I mean, Flame's still demonstrating mastery of the 1v1, though. That all that pressure that led to that tower dive was Flame's early trading there in that lane.
And it was a very good timing on the gank as well. So, yeah, I mean, look, he's still a great lane. No one is going to come here and say that Flame doesn't deserve to be in this squad. I mean, the argument about whether he should be a starter or not will rage all season from all parties. But it's good to see him pick up an assist. It's good to see him winning in CS against Anar. And the sky's always the limit with a mechanically skilled player like Flame.
Yeah, off to a good start so far as Imp down the bottom. Not so good for him, unfortunately. A little bit behind STYZ and CS, but to be expected here. Good Sentinel. They will actually spot out UJ and I think believe spot the STYZ recall as well. So Imp going to get a bit more free time down the bottom lane. Got a very early Vampiric Scepter, actually, to start off his lane.
Yeah, the two main builds we've seen from Callistus are either the Vamp Scepter into Hurricane, so maybe the recurve bow next, or just going for a straight Blade the Ruin King. So obviously the attack speed focus to kind of synergize with that rend ability. And the turret dive's coming in.
Oh, coming through a Luka, not transforming in time, and Schwann gets another kill in the top lane. Great dive, LGD.
Yeah, great dive timing once again right here. Now a Luka's kind of in no man's land. He's 0-2-0 behind in CS to a Rumble. And we can see here the Roam's not finishing.
No, not quite. Schwann actually looking to get aggressive, maybe. Ninja, though, to his credit, doing very well in the lane, even on CS, but is looked to be a bit more proactive and exert a lot more pressure onto Wayless Zed, especially pre-6.
Yeah, picked up that Traco, of course, was in a very, very close to picking up a clean 1-4-0 right there. The CS value is close, as you mentioned, and Ninja and Azir as a champion scales so well into the late game. There is hope for Ninja in this mid lane from Water Elite.
I mean, that was our question. Who can step up on Water Elite? And looks like Ninja and STYZ might be enabled reasonably well in this game, so we'll see how it develops. But LGD still off to a good lead here, about 1,500 gold ahead for them. Double Builder Water Colors is completed as well. Looks like Imp is going to go for the Blade of the Ruin King.
Yeah, and Ninja is winning these trades in the mid lane, so it's only 8 minutes to the game, but that is a small win for World League in a game where we were focusing on what sort of small advantages they could take. And yep, it is going to be the Blade of the Ruin King. It's probably the most reliable build. Hurricane works best as kind of a snowball build, but can really wreck team fights. But Blade of the Ruin King, especially in a 1v1 situation, when it comes to damage to neutrals especially, gonna be super, super huge DPS to the Dragon War Imp.
Yeah, really strong there. I'm trying to remember, I might have been Imp who popularized the similar Vayne build as well, which was Bork into Phantom Dancer. That of all the great Korean AD carries, that could have been someone else, but High Mobility was definitely the name of that build, and Imp is no stranger to a champion like Vayne, or in this case, Kalista.
Obviously, that's been a meta build for so long that I can't really track it back. Obviously, Piglet was a huge fan of that build as well. Double F, one of the late converts to that build, but the Ruin King into Phantom Dancer, especially with the Phantom Dancer adjustments coming in later patches, we will start seeing more Phantom Dancers, and that will really benefit those people that used to fit it into their build before Static Shiv really took things over.
Well, I'll have to check my Korean esports history after the game, but right now Aluka running out of rage here with Xuan looking towards the top lane. Flame has been very aggressive in this top lane, about 10 CS ahead. Looking like the Flame everyone knows and loves and wanted to see here on this team. Finally in a 1v1 matchup, he looks very comfortable, even in Rumble versus Gnar.
And even though Wayless passed over Ward, Aluka's still very aggressively positioned here. He's in a lot of trouble.
It could be here. The Dragon actually started up by World Elite, though, but Xuan will kick Aluka in a Wayless, sorry, now moving in a Zog. Good bounce there from Aluka, but the Zedot's going to come in, and Aluka is completely dead by Zed. World Elite, though, will pick up their first Dragon of the series, in fact, so not a bad trade there.
Yeah, very good rotation coming out from World Elite right there. They're just relentlessly picking on Aluka right now, and at this point, it probably doesn't have any major function. Losing a Dragon for a third kill on a 0-3-0 Aluka, it's not a big advantage at all. In fact, it's definitely a loss for LGD.
Blue buff steal away here as well. Looks like Wayless might get credit for another blue. Does pick it up for himself, and that's a good steal away from the mana hungry Azir as well. UJ down the bottom also appears to be in some sort of peril. Ninja does continue CSing along. 75 to 71, not bad. And with Wayless roaming out, Ninja is getting a little more comfortable in this lane.
And I can confirm it's the now standard Rend Emax on Imp right here. It's going to be EQ into W, I'd have to think.
Spirit down the bottom as well, looking for a gank. Has his ultimate available, but does not pull the trigger. Flash coming back up also, but doesn't quite want to dive Kalista down. A pretty sticky duo there. Or slippery duo, more accurately.
I mean, a slippery duo just because of Imp's passive, but then once you add the Janna, once you start scaling levels in team fights with all the ability for mobility on this Kalista, it's going to be so hard to pin down Imp in team fights.
PLL just dodging a binding down there as well. Imp continuing to CS well. Looks like he's making good use of the passive. Xuan down the bottom now as well. Going to go into be 3v3. Your Spirit's going to jump in on top of Imp now. Looks like UJ in trouble. Does get kicked by Lee Sin. Imp though in trouble. Good ultimate there from PLL to reset. And now the teleport's come through as well. Spirit in a whole host of trouble. Actually goes down there to Flame. And now Aluka down the bottom. Hasn't quite transformed yet. Xuan going to dive back in those OSDYs. He nets his way back as well. Aluka does not flame back in the top, but he'll flash out. Survives on just a sliver of health. And LGD get two clean kills. SDYZ gets the ult blocked by Flame.
And not even an exit kill. SDYZ's in trouble. He's dead.
Oh, goes in. Xuan does dive the turret, hitting the Q. Beautiful play there. And now Aluka actually can't even get the kill. Flame misses the first harpoon. Going to look for the second, but misses it. Imp, though, flashing aggressively forward, and Xuan gets the double.
It is disgusting that World Elite did not pick up a kill right there. The amount, the ability of juggling turret aggro, the flashes away from turret aggro, picking up four kills there in that trade. LGD, they're a top team, Pastry Time, and they're showing why.
They really are. Even with the debut of Kalista in the LPL, Imp still looking strong there, and that was a wonderful teleport by Flame, who is honestly, for me, been the star of this game so far. Him and Xuan have done so much work in the first 12 minutes.
I think Xuan will feel a bit hard done by 5-0-2. So much map pressure put out from Xuan as we see Spirit almost face check Flame in that brush. Twen's Lee Sin, I have to say, very impressive. For one of the more afterthoughts of the LGD match lineup here, probably the least heralded player by a country mile, doing very well.
Oh, Imp does get bowled up, but Spirit will not chase him in. No ultimate left there for that Rengo. He's just going to proxy a little bit behind. Try and do some damage to that bottom turret. Sun turret does fall in the mid there. But LGD, I believe, do have... World Elite actually have a turret. It seems like they did take the mid turret out. So, again, Ninja having a decent game so far.
And Ninja has been very capable this game. 103 to 94 CS. Remember, Zed is one of the more favorable matchups against Azir. Not so much in early laning. It's still a ranged versus melee matchup. But, you know, after 6, and especially with a 5-0-2 jungler, you'd expect Zed to be all over Ninja, but Ninja's done very capably and starting to put his hand up in this game a little bit more as someone who, with a bit of help from the jungle, with a bit of snowball, can actually look to carry.
Yeah, SDYZ picks up the second turret for World Elite there as well, as Caitlyn with a now Berserker Greaves, but just had the pickaxe BF, so with Boots 1 there, doing a lot of damage to the bottom tower. Going to force impact. He'll farm up that wave. Wayless now. Wishwen and PYL going in. Actually, Ninja could be low. Great ultimate, though, from Ninja. Completely blocks Lee Sin. Oh, actually, Wayless going to dive back in instead. That should kill him, and it does there. PYL with the ulti. Zol will heal Wayless back up. Spirit, though, will get kicked there by Shwen. He's doing so much damage early on this Lee Sin. But SDYZ is joined in now as well. Going to maybe look down the chase. PYL, he does get bound. Caitlyn going to look in, but Flame now down the bottom. Zol gets the kill in his Spirit with his ultimate. Now Yuta getting dived and gets killed by Wayless. And LGD just all over World Elite.
It's getting nasty for World Elite so quickly there. Twen almost soloed Spirit with a Q that went wide. He accidentally hit the invisible Rengar and almost instant killed him despite not having any damage items on top of that warrior enchant. And 5,000 gold is the lead, and it's just funny how fast these games kind of fall apart from World Elite. Solid laning from their mid laner. Obviously their top laner was well beaten by Flame, but even with that early dragon, even with those percentage stats, it's really fallen apart for World Elite.
Yeah, Imp got the bottom turret there as well. While all the action mid was going on, doesn't quite have enough to finish his Blade of the Ruined King, but it'll be very close. They've picked up the Berserkeries, which are crucial on Kalista.
Any sort of attack speed-based champion, the reason why I say that for Kalista is that any champion who has an auto-attack-related modifier, for example, Twitch's Expunge, or Vayne's Silver Bolts, or in this case, Kalista's Rend, really wants to get boots to as fast as possible because you're getting so much better orb walking with every auto, and of course the attack speed naturally synergizes with those abilities. The moment that you can stay on a target, and of course Kalista doesn't need flat moves because she has so many mini little jumps from her passive, it just adds up when it comes to Rend damage. And we're going to see, hopefully this game, some of the massive damage potential of Rend, especially on those neutrals.
Yeah, I mean, Imp also getting value just from the boots. Movement speed, Martial Poise scales that way as well. So doing some really fancy dancing here in the mid now. Just going to clear out some of those creeps. And opening up again. I mean, STYZ, Shwen actually, never mind. Onto Ninja. The buff did go down. He steals it away. And Ninja, feeling very hard done by, maybe going to chase in. Does move to Sand Soldier forward there. But Imp is now in the house. Looking to take out the Scuttle Crab. World Elite grouped very aggressively together here, but LGD steal away the buff once again.
And this is the first series where Imp hasn't had to hard carry his team, and it's the other members, actually the top side of the map, who've really been the cause for optimism for LGD here. 206 is Flame. He's done fantastic. Well, actually went for a really fast Void Staff right here. I mean, there's only really the Hex Drinker to speak of in terms of magic resist, but obviously if you have the gold for it, it's not the worst purchase if you're a Rumble player. But it's been Twen. It's been all about Twen and Wayless.
Yeah, it really has. And Flame, I think Flame fans around the world are rejoicing. Actually, Flame does go down there to UJ. They're going to move PYL forward. They almost hits that NATO after being put up by Kalista. Oh, that's a great monsoon there from PYL. And Aluka maybe looking to chase up as Imp did get bowled in there. Shwen going to dive back in as well. Ninja actually getting a kill into PYL. Shwen now low as well. Spirit flashes forward, but he'll flash out as well. And Imp does escape with his life, but that were two easy kills for World Elite.
And round the back, Wayless actually turret dives to get the one kill. It's just a kill trade right there. Somehow I don't think we're going to see quite the turnaround that we saw in the SHRC series earlier when Insect was going a bit mad with power and his team was so far ahead. But some over-aggression from LGD.
Yeah, a little bit, but they'll take the 3-4 and trade. They'll still win out. World Elite, though, looking for their second dragon of the game. I actually forgot about that part of this game where they went for the dive top and World Elite got their first dragon. So, you know, all things aside, in World Elite, despite the gold devs are looking decent in, they're going to get aggressed on Dragon low, but not quite done yet. The dragon will finally go down. Flame's actually come down as well. Pick up the first kill onto Azir. Now Aluka in trouble as Imp and Flame are going to look to go over. No, can't quite make it in. And Luka will get out, so just the two kills traded for Dragon. Oh my god, Shwen does get Nara ulted back there. Great Q there. Does not walk into the wall of all the Dark Binding, but again, the trade there, not too bad for World Elite.
And we kind of said the path for World Elite was to show something. You can at least say that in the mid lane, Ninja's been more than competitive. He's actually been very much in that lane. And their Dragon and neutral objective control has been pretty good. You look at the wards here, and the wards have definitely fallen down a little bit, especially compared to the Vision Stranglehold that you kind of expect with Imp and PYL. Whenever those two are ahead, PYL especially is wonderful at that warding, much like Marta was previously with Imp right there. But they've been on point with their dragon control. That's still something to take away because you build a successful team on having all those constituent parts of a winning League of Legends game down. Dragon control, it's a small thing, but it's something they're starting to get.
Yeah, and it might be the little things for World Elite. Again, a team that has not had the strongest start. And to be fair, they have played an unbelievable amount of good teams. With the exception of M3 so far in their run, they have played nothing but top 5 teams in their first 3 weeks of the LPL. So it has been a difficult road so far for World Elite. And game after game, it does feel like they're showing a little bit more each time.
And you take things from these games and wonder, what's World Elite versus Gamti going to look like? What's World Elite versus Energy Pacemaker going to look like? These teams that we're expecting to be in the relegation places. Those are the realistic games where World Elite can build momentum and pick up wins. So even if they leave this series with a 2-0 loss, there's still potential that they'll start to pick up little things that in practice against the lower ranked teams might be very useful.
And you mentioned Dragon Control in this game as well. I feel like Imp's AD carry, this might be the first time he's played something other than Sivir, and there is seems to be hurting LGD's early objective control just a little bit.
Remember, they're losing objective control with a Rumble. Like, that's usually the... Once a team picks Rumble, that's usually saying, all right, we've got at least the first two Dragons, guys. We've got the access to the Equalizer. And of course, this is a big Rumble. It's been doing very well this game as Flame. But of course, they've been focusing on snowballing his 1v1 lane more than they've been focusing on Dragon Control. So we don't want to go too far in praising World Elite's play right here, but they're at least trading objectives rather than just losing everything at one go.
Well, I'll tell you right now, Lord Flame cares not for your neutral objectives, Papa Smithy. He's all about the 1v1 kills, and he's done very well in that regard so far. I mean, we do expect a change-up of the styles for the squad here when they do bring Flame in. This has been a very Flame-esque game, I feel like.
Despite the fact that he's on the Acorn champion.
He's played a lot of the Acorn champions. He's played so much Rumble.
It is really amusing how much Rumble he's played so far this season.
But Rumble's very good, and Flame clearly plays a very different style of Rumble than Acorn does. Much more aggressive with his build here with the Void Star early on. Wants to get in and get kills and make plays for his team. And it's worked out so far. 14-4 is the scoreline right now on kills. 5-2 in turrets. And LGD, despite being two dragons down, still healthily about 6,000 gold ahead.
And it's the carries that have a lot of the gold here. Imp, for once, is sitting down the back. But 5-2-0, 5-0-5 for the mid lane jungle combination. And that's a lot of magic penetration stacked onto Flame right here. I think it's pretty much true damage across the board for that Rumble.
I told you, he just wants to kill the champions here. Rumble is really keen to get that damage down here, as we did have the Blade of the Ruined King finished up by Imp there as well. So that's going all to plan. PYL also with a Magize here. Very aggressive by LGD support player.
And I'm going to have to speculate, but it's probably going to be the Yomu's Ghostblade second coming out for Imp right here, working towards what looks like a Brutalizer. So it's going to be all about movement speed. It makes a lot of sense with a champion with just so much hypermobility scaling.
Yeah, we've seen a little bit of that with Twitch sometimes, the purple build coming out potentially here for Imp as well. So we'll see where he does develop there, but certainly looks like it here with those current components. Now Red Buff actually going to get aggressed on by LGD. And Schwen looks like still the drone for Imp, maybe the beneficiary of a very juicy red buff, and he will indeed. Rends that away, and LG will continue pushing World Elite back towards the lower third of the map.
Flame's actually dead.
He's very dead there. Ninja actually going to get credit for that kill, as UJ now forced to run away as well. STYZ joined the ultimate there to get the kill into Flame. 3-2-7 now for the Rumble player.
And from the minimap, it looked like Flame was caught in the rotation there by Spirit ulting, so... Good to pick up another kill on that champion. Aluka gets to push up top, but he's going to have to teleport bot because Wailers' Spirit pushes on.
Yeah, and the big beneficiary as well, still for World Elite though, is Ninja's Azir. He's thrown a lot of confidence on this champion. He's almost at his Zonyas now as well for a 2-item power spike. Wailers down the bottom though, he's pushing it onto Aluka. He does have his ultimate if he wants to go in, but Spirit's actually off to the side here. Maybe looking to get a kill, never mind. We'll just clear out his red buff instead. And World Elite feeling a little bit claustrophobic on this map right now.
They definitely are, and I think... The good thing you can say is that he does have the gold. He's actually finished the Zonyas right here. World Elite are just looking for friends, because we've seen games where, for example, on the Riven jungle, Spirit got very ahead. He just didn't have any friends on the team that could really team fight with the item lead that he had. In this case, Ninja's got items, but Caitlyn's in full power trough right now. Able to pick up the Zeal, but really isn't going to have that team fight impact until later in the game. There's never been a case where two of World Elite's carries are really in kind of power points, and that's where they're struggling.
And you know, that might just be a drafting issue for World Elite. We've definitely noted that the drafting could be a little bit cleaner in places. I think the last game there between these two teams, a big point as well. Wailers does find a pink ward though. We'll slap that one down. Ninja joining him along with UJ Spirit and STYZ. Almost the whole crew, but Aluka's down as well. But he pops his Bork and the Ghostblade and he'll run away home.
Yeah, there was a lot of members of World Elite there, but not able to get a pick. And of course, up top, Flame's just happy pushing.
Of course he is. He's Flame here. Getting the CS lead here. 20 up now on this Rumble here. Building in, getting the damage done, trying to get aggressive here and create pressure on the map for LGD. And again, just so much space for LGD in this game. World Elite definitely keeping in it for sure, despite all the early kills. But it's going to take, I think, a big Caitlyn here and a big Ninja as well in this Azir to get some of those mid to late game team fights rolling.
And wards always tell a story. You look at the wards for World Elite here. They're defensive. They're almost emergency. That pink ward, especially on their red side jungle, is almost an emergency ward here. They realize they have no business going for any neutral objectives whatsoever. And that's a bit worrying considering they actually have the Dragon Timer because they've taken the only two Dragons of the game.
Yeah, and that could mean that in 40 seconds time, LGD are going to pick up their first Dragon of the game. But World Elite starting to spread out a bit more now, trying to get some more visions out for themselves. We'll have to see here. Looks like all of LGD are stacked up as well, right on top of a Pink Ward for themselves. Looking for a pick potentially. Going to sweep out now as well. Schwinn actually does find a ward there in the bush. Has to be a bit careful though. Good Q actually landing in. Does safeguard away. POR cleans out the ward and a beautiful little dance there to clean out that vision.
And the Dragon Dance is going to start very soon. No real wards to realistically contest this objective, but they do have the timer. So I imagine they're probably just going to ignore it and go and take the empty lane farm top. And given the positioning of STYZ, seems like that's what they've committed to.
Yep. We'll just collect the farm where they can and give over the third Dragon here for OG. And actually really like that choice from World Elite. They just can't really afford to fight. They don't even have super good pick tools either if they wanted to do it that way. So they say, you know what? We need STYZ to get going. Let's give them the empty lane farm and maybe fight again in 5-10 minutes time.
And Caitlyn really hits that power spike again when she has those three big AD items to trade on her range. Obviously, she lacks a true steroid until she gets her attack speed high enough for Headshot to be a really relevant teamfight spell. But, you know, she'll scale up. If there's a lack of pressure, she completes the Static Shiv, one major item away from really being that late-game Kate that is just as obnoxious as the early-game Kate laning.
The wave clear not too bad on the World Elite side either, as LGD do take out the bottom Tier 2 turret now. So 7-3 in turrets, and LGD are just taking over the red side jungle here. World Elite, again, they are running out of map to play on.
And it's sweeping wards very aggressive, but Schwinn might be in trouble.
Yeah, found Schwinn. Spirit now getting jumped. A good safeguard away. The ultimate does come in there for Caitlyn, but Schwinn pretty tanky. POL in there as well with his Madrius helping out, and he'll be safe for now.
Yeah, but World Elite, that's the reality, is that their view of the map, their safe zone is maybe their Raptors. I mean, to be honest, it feels like Raptors is overextending for World Elite. For your friendly Raptors to be overextending is not good times.
Spirit, though, will collect them. I think Imp was actually thinking about them trying to take that objective away, but Spirit will get it for himself. They're using that smite. Wayless up towards the top side of the map now. Look to split bush for himself. Does have the two purple items done. Blade plus the Yeoman's Ghost Blade. I guess it's two blades there. And a pickaxe now as well for probably a last whisper third.
And we wondered who it would be to split bush against this Azir. I guess it could be... split bush against the Zed. Sorry, I guess it could be Azir. He does have access to Zhonya's, but a long lane isn't really Azir's best friend. He likes to sit under a turret, whether that's the turret he creates with his passive or just one of the standard structures on the map. So, be interesting to see who they send against this Zed. Right now, they're just grouping, so... if there's no overextension right here, it could be a free objective for Wayless.
Yeah, World Elite might be able to collect something. Spirit actually popping his ultimate, wants to make a play here. Flame looks at the target, gonna go in there, the bowler just wide there, and the teleport comes immediately and then gets cancelled there by World Elite. So Aluka wanted to join, but bit of a misengage there by the Rengar.
And the waves, obviously the sixth man are pushing very hard in the top lane right here. And look at Zed, he's ready to catch up anyone, hopefully STYZ in transition.
Yeah, Wayless is so aggressively positioned. In fact, almost all of LGD feel like they live in the World Elite jungle now, and that's not a fun feeling as a team when you have to pull your ward so far back that you feel like you can't leave your base effectively, and LGD can take advantage of all the vision they have, going to go for Baron right away.
Yeah, the red and blue pings and say, no, it's up.
Going in there, the ultimate pop by Yuji, that's not a bad position actually, but does get DPS down by Flame. Schwinn actually will clean him out there as well. Now Spirit in a whole host of trouble. Does flush over the wall to be safe, but looks like he'll get popped there. Lee Sin picking that next one up, the double for Schwinn. Now Wayless going in, does get the kill into Caitlyn, and World Elite just getting routed now by LGD. Ninja and Aluka trying to run away. Schwinn still so aggressive. Imp looking to chase in there as well. Ninja actually going in for the damage, may be able to get the kill into Imp. He's forced to flush out. But a 3-for-1 trade there with Flame going down. Imp though, very low. Ninja gets the kill for himself, picks up Imp's gold. And that's not a bad trade at all.
Yeah, Ninja, half health, has mana right here, showing the power of this Azir pick. It was Azir denying so many low members from LGD the chance to finish off that team fight with an ace. So very solid play from Ninja. He played that fight very smartly. Actually has the Zhonya's available still. So it was a very, very smart play there from Azir, but... the team fight's still going comfortably in LGD's advantage.
And maybe the other issue is, apart from the gold lead, obviously, that LGD have, we've talked about Caitlyn kind of going through a power trough right now. Needs to power up, does have the pickaxe, so Last Whisper is most of the way complete, but still a bit more gold for STYZ to farm up before he hits that there. Azir might be the thing that bridges the Caitlyn there as well, but I think if World Elite can find a good team fight and not be too far behind, looking good. It's just a matter of, can Caitlyn actually get the farm she needs?
And we were speculating about where Imp's build was going to go. He's actually gone for the armor penetration build. He has both the Brutalizer and the Last Whisper completed before any sort of other attack speed steroid or big BF sword item. I guess what you can say about this, it might be Deceptive Burst or Deceptive Kill Securing coming out from the Rend ability here, just because once he gets 5, 6, 7, 8, 10 stacks on, that Rend is going to be doing massive execution damage.
I'd be curious to see as well if Imp even maybe goes for the other Brutalizer item. We see a lot of Ghost play, but the Black Cleaver is not the worst in this build as well.
Sees the armor stack, it could be possible. So your Twin is aggressed on, but Spirit has to back out.
Yeah, Spirit again trying to make plays for his team. 2-4-1, not the worst performance on Ringo for Spirit. Again, it's a big comfort champion for him. Seen him play it a lot both in the LPL and the end of last year
the
as
flank
well.
Is on though, Pastry Time.
He's indeed. Flame is off around the side here. UJ getting aggressed on a bit by Imp. Spirit's actually popped his ulti. He's found Flame. He balls him up, but Flame pops the ulti immediately to zone the rest of them off. And LGD will maybe look for an engage, but Orderly just going to back off and stay grouped in mid.
But a bit of a misfire with that ultimate. So it's a big cooldown down, a big teamfight control ultimate down. I think it would be a little bit over-aggressive to go on Baron without the Equalizer available.
Yeah, we saw what happened as well last time they attempted it. Ninja's Azir, not a joke, has picked up a Void Staff now as well. So I think the biggest shining light might just be Ninja's Azir here in this game for Wardley. It looks very strong so far.
Wardley have been very smart in their position here. They're actually trying to cut off LGD from going back into this lane for getting easy wave here. So they're trying to get position on this inner turret right here, but they are aware of the threat that Wayless presents. If Wayless isn't showing in top, it is a big risk to be just pushing straight down this mid lane.
Yeah, Wayless is going to go in towards the top side now, show himself very soon, and start clearing that all out. Wardley will stay 5 strong in the mid lane, though they'll now start to back off. I think realizing that Zed is in fact split pushing them in towards the top side of the map. And LGD going to farm more space, push World Elite back towards their own Nexus.
And they push 4 to 5 members of World Elite towards the top lane right here. And it opens up Dragon as an objective.
Yeah, early Ghostblade they use for Wayless for turret damage. Does get slowed by the Boomerang, though. Spirit also as well does have the snare ready, but Wayless should have his W back. No, not quite. He's actually in trouble. They're good ultimate. They're coming in. And Spirit does miss the first ball. Of Wayless, though, getting locked down. He does get the kill on the Spirit. And Iluka might not be able to catch him. Wayless is so low. PYL's here as well. And Wayless gets away scot-free.
And Twin actually manages to catch STYZ in the transition coming back here. So it's going to be at best a 2-for-2 trade. Meanwhile, the Dragon comes down. The fight continues. Isn't up.
Yeah, it looks like Ninja gonna dive back in as well. Iluka does find a slow onto PYL, who has to be a little bit careful. Jaina does have a roll. That's actually maybe a bit of a misuse, but will be safe there. Did knock them back just enough. And LGD low, but not dead.
And this is one of the few times that Azir struggles. It's in all this transition. Azir, when he has setup time, when he can get his Sand Soldiers down and use them to its maximum, is a wonderful team fighter. But it's been so much map rotation, as expected with a split pushing Zed, that World Elite are losing out both in terms of wanting to force a team fight, their only real shot at winning this game, and they're losing out objectives because, of course, during all that tumultuous action up top, the second dragon comes up to equal the neutral score for LGD.
Yeah, Imp down the bottom lane as well, pushing on his own as well. Maybe even getting a secondary split pusher on for LGD because Kalista seems fairly safe in this situation, especially when LGD have so much control over the map already.
Absolutely. Doesn't have any ward coverage, but is not concerned about any assassination potential coming out from World Elite right here. Is going to back now. Going to go for a defensive item here, so it's actually happy with their damage output. And to be honest, with an 8-0-6 Lee Sin still doing relevant team damage despite being built so tanky, and of course Wayless and Flame are doing very good damage in these team fights, kind of understandable just to be about ensuring that in a long fight he gets so many orders off that, again, trading on the power of Rend in these fights.
We'll have to see. Flame, as you mentioned, 3 items for him now as well. The Zonya's has been completed here for his Rumble to go along with his Void stuff and his Haunting guys. So Flame is doing quite a lot of damage, and he's been positioning pretty aggressively as well to try in these fights, as Baron Vision will get cleaned out now by LGD as well. Ninja will come in defend. Azir so good at killing Pink Lords. And they'll clear out a little bit of vision back for themselves, but LGD, I think they have a plan now. They want to try and force Ridley to either fight them a Baron or Schwinn. Never mind, it was just the blue buff.
It was a very nice move, but yes, it was just the blue buff.
Ninja actually looking to secure it for himself. This will be quite crucial for the next fight around. Baron does get it for himself, so that's a good secure there by World Elite's mid laner. And LGD have to be a little bit careful. Don't want to go too far on this force around the Baron, because, again, Azir, when he's got time to set up, looks very strong in these team fights.
The needlessly large Rod has been picked up by PYL here, so to go with that, Medjai is actually going to have very large shields. Going to have quite a good burst of AD as well, because, of course, it does scale on the AD as well. Just tabbing over to this Jaina. 217 AP, that is a very powerful shield coming out there. Going to be about 400 shield or so. So very team fight relevant right here. this the Janna Zed combo is actually one we don't discuss very often, but the ability for Zed to go in with the Janna Shield, with that extra AD, blow up a target, then come back to someone who can peel for him with the changes in how the death mark works is actually a very nice combo.
Yeah, and Wailers back down towards the bottom lane. Gonna look to keep split pushing for his team. Probably don't need him for team fighting, so he'll now work on the bottom side of the map here. 8 towers down for LGD. Wailers gonna look to make it 9 or more. As Vodalite are gonna clear out some Baron Vision for themselves as well. Lots of pink bloods being felled here as Spirit jumps on top of that one. So they'll regain vision around the pit, which is important for Vodalite. And all they really need to do if they want to get a good fight going is maybe farm for 10 more minutes. It's just a matter of how much pressure will LGD put on them.
And will LGD ever opt into a 5v5 team fight that really works towards a Vodalite's strength? Obviously Ninja at this point is very big, short of a death cap maybe, but still very, very team fight damage relevant. SDYZ, he's got the 4 AD carry items. The fifth one will really push him over the edge in terms of being a late game force on that Caitlyn. So they do have very good team fighting options right here, but LGD have such great split, and there's a real lack of people on World Elite to deal with that split, that why opt into a 5v5 fight you could realistically lose?
Yeah, SDYZ though, picking up speed here, and that's sort of what we want to see. The three items, a threshold for Caitlyn, and I guess Tristana as well as another strong late game carry is really the part where you start to get over your power drop and into your power spike once again, although Schwen has been cut off here. Spirit's going to dive in on top. At least it is so tanky. PYL as well does throughout the tornado. Now the rest of LGD come in. Flame going to try and cut them all off with an equalizer. Schwen does land the Q there onto a Ninja, but he will back off here in LGD. Again, just comfortable keeping up the 4-1.
And very important cooldown blown by UJ as well. No Morgana ultimate available for any sort of team fight coming up soon. And Wailers, he's just happy this team fight goes back. He's got a lot of gold probably on the mind. Looking at the minion waves right here, of course the red minion wave is going to be pushing in the bottom lane. It's about even in the top lane matchup. So, I mean, the minion waves aren't oppressive yet for LGD, but you have to think they're going to set up a minion wave push in both lanes and then really try to take some objectives.
Yeah, and a quick apology there. LGD only have 5 turrets. Silly Azir turrets trolling me, but still a really strong stranglehold over this map in general. LGD with a massive lead now as well.
Yeah, just
apparently also can't count. It's 4 turrets. I didn't take the tier 2 in the mid. Azir was blocking me.
Yeah, but Azir was blocking you
Son
right
of my
there.
Eyes. I apologize, everyone.
Ah, spectator mode and Azir turrets.
Always a fun one here, but LGD still 8,000 gold ahead here in this one, looking for either their next dragon hit to make it, I think it would be 3, no, 3, yeah, it would be 3, or their first Baron, of course, as well, but they do need to get stuff going here. Wailers' split push was effective early on, but hasn't quite continued to get them structures, of course, not because I can't count turrets.
And we're starting to get a bit of a mid-game lull here. I guess it's mostly because it was mostly actually caused by WE, just because they got those first two dragons. Imagine how different this game would be if we were sitting on the fourth, the fifth dragon. Spirit is looking to go in on Kalista.
He actually goes right in on top. The Black Shield there helping out as well, but Spirit not tanky enough and does go down to the imp. So a 4v5 now will be started by Worldly. Flame popped his ulti, I think, for a bit of extra damage just to zone them off. Feluca looking to transform now as on Ninja. Also ready with a Sandstorm for LGD. We'll just take their kill. Wailers already doing work down the bottom. No need to go in further.
Yeah, Spirit was just over-aggressive right there. Fell for his initiation. And as you mentioned, the bot lane here, it's going to be a dead turret for Wailers.
Yeah, and he's looking to work on the inhibitor as well. How much fancy footwork does he have for? Aluka does ult him back. He ults back onto SDYZ, actually. Maybe looking to go through. Shadow plays back. Beautiful play there for Wailers. Does pick up SDYZ, and Yuta's actually in trouble. Might get sniped by a Shuriken, but it's not enough here. Aluka does take him up, but LGD, they're onto Baron. They'll take the trade.
Yeah, Wailers takes out the AD carry. Almost gets a second. Doesn't quite get the inhibitor, but I love the flash straight on top to guarantee the death mark. Confirm. And at the same time, free Baron.
Yeah, and LGD will take it here. 10,000 gold ahead now in this game. Looking to close things out. They kind of needed something to give there, and eventually it was the Baron with Wailers breaking the bottom side of the base as well. So really the game opened up now for LGD. They were already insanely far ahead. Going to look to make it a third dragon here as well. And I just noticed, well, Wailers, in fact, maybe PYL and Wailers having a bit of fun in this game. Because not only does PYL have that Needle Seal Large Rod and the Magizer you mentioned, Wailers has a Zephyr in his inventory.
Yes, and we did, of course, talk about the Mana Stinger coming out last week. The Stinger transforms into a Zephyr eventually. But coming back to the breaking of the base, it's so important for this LGD lineup because they've only got one ranged auto attacker alongside Janna, and that's Imp on the Kalista. Not a very long range champion right there. So they would have struggled to siege otherwise, but having that down turret in the bot lane negates the advantage that, say, a Caitlyn Azir comp with great wave clear has, because they can just push down the bottom right there and World Elite are going to be hesitant to pick a fight.
Yeah, and PYL going to add a blasting one to his Nidusa Lodra, looking for a Death Cap support Janna potentially here, as well as Imp, with the help of the powered up Baron Minions, will push in onto another Azir turret here, just to make the Spectator Clan even more insane looking here. That'll be the 11th total tower, including Sun Turrets here. And if they get this tier 2, the 5th total tower, Schwen dives in, actually the Black Shield digger down into Spirit, so he should be okay. But Flame now chasing down as well, dodges the first button and looking to go onto Spirit. Good ball though, the ultimate used immediately though by Flame. Schwen looking to go in as well, Wardly flash out of the way though, but LGD still pressuring that mid lane.
Yeah, very big minion, red minion wave pushing the top lane as well, but a blue minion wave in the bottom means the global pressure is about even. So it's going to take a while for LGD to force a fight right here, but you know they're ready to go in.
Yeah, you know, with the Zephyr, with the Rabadons looking here for PYL as well, I think it's important to highlight that the Chinese players and teams in general, very emotional, very they really play with a lot of heart when they play. So a game that is for LGD where they're quite probably having a bit of fun here with some of these item choices, a big confidence boost on moving forward, because it is the start of their LPL weekend.
Absolutely, it's the start of their weekend. They should take a 2-0 win right here. It's not completely in the books, especially with how we saw Starhorn Royal Club lose a very one-sided game, but way less in the bottom lane. His split push is complete.
Yep, can't confirm now. 7 actual turrets going down as they're going to start the fight here. Aluga going in with the Gnar ultimate, but Imp gets the first kill. Now Schwen getting chased down as well. Imp is kiting back beautifully on that Kalista, but there's the next kill. 2-for-1 actually, with Wayless still coming around the back potentially now as well. Imp and Flame will move forward. Wayless did look to rotate over, but settle for the inhibitor in bot instead. And a good trade again for LGD. They'll take it with the Wayless doing work in the other side of the map.
Wow, actually able to pick up a kill with a max range auto attack from a Sand Soldier right there.
In trouble now as well. Aluka going to look in the decently timed boomerang. Wayless going to come back down as well. And Aluka just going to get crushed down here. But Ninja actually answering back. He will survive there. And that's a good trade. 4-for-1 there for World Elite.
And they have to pay for their overconfidence there. A very messy fight coming out from LGD, punished by World Elite. You cannot ignore the damage from this Azir. W, just putting out a Sand Soldier auto was enough to kill him from about 400 health. So it's still a lot of damage coming there, as STYZ, of course, precariously close to a backing Flame.
Yep, does juke into the bush at the wrong time, unfortunately, but picking up speed again, still getting 059 for STYZ. Not the most glamorous score, but a big bucket of CS there to go along with it. 332, finished up his QSS now as well, and does have a BF sword, so going strong. We mentioned Ninja before, 4 big damage items for him now as well. So if there is a shot here in this game, it is on the back of the 2 World Elite carries.
It is definitely on the back of the 2 World Elite carries. The Rabadons really amplifies the damage coming out of this as he almost 700 AP has Ninja right now. He's done his job this game. I guess that's the one thing they can take away, is that, okay, Ninja's Azir, it's relevant. It's something that you have to consider and pick and ban, just because he's shown a lot of proficiency on that champion.
And even further than that for me, because Ninja has shown plenty of competency on a lot of other champions. He clearly has his comfort. He likes his range. Champions are a bit safer, but he's not just looked good on Azir. He's looked assertive, and that's probably
decisive.
The
sure.
Yeah, and that's probably the most important thing for me, is that Ninja has not just been like, yeah, I can play this champion pretty well, and you know, have a strong lane and have things go well. He is really playing to win these team fights, which is maybe the first time we've seen it from World Elite.
And that's kind of the heartening thing about this game in general, is that compared to the one-sided stomp of the previous game, okay, LGD have looked in control this game, but there are little things we can pick out and say, all right, World Elite can work on this. All right, World Elite can develop this. All right, World Elite can figure this out. And that's the start of something.
Yeah, for sure. Here's STYZ getting plenty of farm, actually, with the super minions pushing in, and LGD probably having a little fun with, again, some of these item choices, but have to be careful. This is not a late-game combination you want to mess with.
It isn't, but it does feel like an unassailable lead. People have said that to their own peril in the past. Shoutcaster's peril, of course, but 10,000 gold, and doesn't even really feel like we've seen Imp really go off in a fight. It wouldn't even be fair to really pass judgment on Kalista based on this game, which is kind of disappointing, because that was like the most exciting part of the draft for me, at least.
Well, we'll see, Papa Smithy. World Elite may yet have you eating your words, but World Elite are definitely still in a big deficit here, and it's important to remind you guys of that. 10,000 gold pretty much ahead here for LGD. I mean, World Elite are stalling well. Azir is a pretty good stall champion with a bunch of turrets and a good amount of wave clear as well. STYZ is getting going. Aluka down the bottom, clearing out some minions as well. He's got a Warmog's armor to go in with the rest of it. They're trying to be very tanky with his Randy ones plus his Banshees, but LGD still looking complete control of this game, and probably most importantly, even if it takes a little while, they're going to go for their 4th and eventually the 5th dragon.
I mean, it's interesting that Caitlyn, despite being 059, is only 400 gold away from a Bloodthirster to basically complete her build. Obviously, she'll eventually change the QSS into a Mercurial Scimitar, but with Bloodthirster especially, she's going to be She's going to be the late game Caitlyn that's still very, very strong right here, as we see. Looks like Trend wants to take this buff.
He's just going to go back in, does get aggressive, smites it away, and actually might be in trouble now. Gets ulted there by Morgana, but there's a safeguard target in Flame. Aluka now teleporting as well. Spirit wants to engage so bad, it's going to go in. The Rumble Orb, beautiful for Flame though, and now they're going to get Dover and SDYZ around the back, trying to make it work with Flame. Pops his Zonies and Ninja back over the top. Actually gets Monsoon back. No, never mind, he got kicked over there, I think, by Schwen. Is now UJ going to get aggressed on by Imp as well. PYL will get dropped there, and it's chaos in this team fight. There's the fourth kill. Spirit going to get chased down for the fifth, and there's a clean five kills for LGD. Game over, unfortunately. LGD gonna push in for the win.
But it was a wonderful equalizer from Flame that really afforded that teamfight win, to the point where, literally, if we get a replay, and hopefully we'll get that as our post-game replay, but the reason why I say a replay is that I was watching SDYZ that fight. He had a lot of damage items. I can tell you he got off maybe 3 auto attacks in a 25-second fight. And as it doesn't matter how many damage items you have as Caitlyn, if you're getting 3 to 4 autos off in a long, extended fight, gonna win.
Yeah, and another stellar performance for LGD to pick themselves up 3 points here against World Elite. And World Elite, we said it, flashes of brilliance potentially there, but not enough to win a full game here, especially against a team that is looking as strong as LGD.
And not enough to take a win, but as we came over a few times, things to take away for their next series. Ninja very impressive on Azir. Objective control in the early game was on point. And we're going to go to a replay here just to kind of look at the early game. We'll roll the tape here. So this is, of course, down the bottom lane right here. Rengar comes in, level 6, goes in very hard, but Spirit's still quite squishy right here. Doesn't get too much done, and you can see Twen at the bottom is zoning out SDYZ completely right here, and their target selection is excellent for LGD right here, as they're able to focus down so many targets. I did love the ultimate from Aluka right there, but it's the turret juggling that's really the thing right here. This is going to be an extended clip, because this actually went for quite a while right here. We thought it was over right there, but Twen hits the Q, goes in right there, still juggling turrets, still juggling turrets. Single health bars on so many people. And I believe Aluka might... not going to get away from this either.
Yeah, another great Q from Schwen, and that's going to clean out the second kill in that engagement. We did talk about Schwen's Lee Sin. Looked incredible there in that game. Just snowballing lanes, left, right, and center. Maybe got a few too many kills for himself, but he'll take it. He absolutely deserved it with that performance.
Absolutely.
And with that, guys, we are going to move into our next match. Cheers. This one is over. Don't go anywhere. More English coming to the LPL. We'll be right after this.